I'm Vaidehi. You might have heard about something called hash tables and feel like you're supposed to know about them. Or you might know a little bit about them, but be unsure about why you need to know. Either way, I want to show you all there is to know about hash tables, and hopefully you'll find them as interesting as I do. My favorite way of thinking about hash tables is by thinking about libraries and all of the books that they have. If we think about some of the biggest libraries in the world and their collection of books, imagine how difficult it would be to find one single specific book in a collection of unsorted books. All the libraries in the world have a great system of organizing and sorting through books. You can think about all of the books in a library as a collection or a data set. In computer science or in programming, the data sets that you have to deal with are generally pretty big. Being able to find one piece of data, just like finding one book on a bookshelf in a huge library of books, is a pretty common task. Hash tables are data structures that are made up of two distinct parts. First, they have an array, which is where the data is actually stored. Anytime you add or remove or want to find an element, it's going to be an element that lives in this array. The second part of a hash table is exactly what makes a hash table so special. We have an array, which is a structure we're already familiar with, but hash tables have also something called a hash function. A hash function is a function that maps to certain locations or indexes in the array. We can use a hash function to create a mapping between an element and where it lives in the array. Another way to think about it is that a hash function tells us how to find an element within the array. If you want to add something to a hash table, you use a hash function to decide where it should live. Similarly, if you want to find something in the hash table, you use the hash function to figure out where to get the item from. Here we have an example of an element, let's say it's a book, and an array, that's our hash table. We want to add this element into our array. We can't just insert it anywhere. Instead, we're going to lean on our hash function to do this logic for us. We'll take our element, which is our input data, and send it to our hash function, asking our hash function where our data should live inside of the array. For now, we won't worry too much about how the hash function decides where to put this element. Let's just say that the hash function magically says this element should live at index 3 in the array. Once the hash function gives us a position for this element, we know where to insert it into this array. Our hash function creates a mapping so that every single time we pass a piece of input to our hash function, it will give us the location of where that input should live inside of our hash table array. It's very important that our hash function always return the same location in the array for the same input. The reason that this is so important is that we use the hash function not just for inserting elements, but also for finding an element and for deleting it. Imagine that we added this element to our hash table and then added a bunch more elements later. If we wanted to find the first element we inserted way back when we started, we should be able to depend on our hash function to tell us its location in the array every single time. Hash tables are made up of sets of pairs, often called ordered pairs made up of K, V, key values. If we look at how a hash function works, we'll see that the key, or the index of the element in the array, maps to a value, which is just the data that lives at that index. What a hash function does is allow us to take a piece of input or a value and find the key for it in the array. If you have a key, you can find the value that lives at that key using a hash function. Let's take a look at an example of a hash table and a hash function using our first metaphor of books on a bookshelf. Let's say that we are sorting our books using a hash function that maps to an array with 12 possible spots in it. This array has indexes between 0 and 11. We could say that this hash table has a size of 12 because there are only 12 possible locations that any element could live at. Each one of these locations, or indexes in this array, is also known as a hash bucket. So, when we insert an element into our hash table, or when we go to retrieve an element, we're going to be pulling the element or adding the element from a hash bucket. Let's say we have a hash function that is fairly simple. This hash function is going to take every single book that we're adding to our book table, and it's going to look at the characters in the book's title. So now that we have a hash table with the size of 12, let's try to actually add some elements to it. In order to do that, we're going to have some kind of hash function to create our mapping. We're going to use a very simple version of a hash function for our purposes. Let's say that this hash function just takes the title of every book and divides it by the size of our hash table. We know that the size of our hash table is 12, since there are 12 hash buckets in it. So every single time we pass a piece of data to our hash function, it's going to take the number of letters in the book's title and divide it by 12. Whatever the remainder of that division is going to be where that item lives in our hash bucket. Let's say that we're trying to insert a book with the title of The Great Gatsby. We're going to take this item and pass it to our hash function. Our hash function will count up the number of letters in this title, and it will use the modulo operator in order to determine what 14 divided by 12 gives us as a remainder. That the reason we're dividing by 12 is because we decided we're going to have our hash function divide by the number of hash buckets. Since our hash table's size is 12, every single input that is passed to our hash function will be divided by 12. In this case, there are 14 characters in the title, The Great Gatsby. 14 divided by 12 gives us a remainder of 2. The modulo operator is pretty common for hashing functions, since it's a very easy way to figure out the remainder of two numbers being divided between one another. Our hash function will tell us that The Great Gatsby can be hashed to the index of 2. So we'll take this item and insert it at hash bucket 2. Let's look at some more examples with two more book titles. The Grapes of Wrath has 16 characters in it. We'll pass it to our hash function. Now we know exactly where this item should live in our hash table. This book has 18 characters in it. So 6 is going to be where we're going to insert The Sound and the Fury into our hash table. You might be able to tell how this can make it very easy for us to find where an item is in our hash table and for us to insert an item into our hash table very quickly. This hash table has only 12 hash buckets. Most hash tables aren't going to be extremely large in size. So there's a chance we could run into a tricky situation. You might be able to guess what this is, but let me show you what I mean. Let's say that we want to add another great book to this hash table we have, The Old Man and the Sea. Remember, we're using the same hashing function, so we're going to use the same exact logic to figure out where this book should go. This book has 18 characters in it. 18 divided by our hash table size, which is 12, gives us 6. We can go to insert this book into our hash table. Here's a problem. We've already inserted a book into this hash bucket. We previously inserted The Sound and the Fury into the hash bucket 6. But now we want to add something else to that same hash bucket. This is what we call a collision. A collision occurs when a hashing function decides that two elements ought to live at the same exact hash bucket. As your data set increases in size, your hash table shouldn't increase too much. A general rule with hash functions is that no hash function will return a unique value for every single element you give it. Because the data set that we're dealing with is going to be larger than our hash table, at some point or another, our hashing function is going to output two elements to the same bucket. Usually, a well-designed hash function will handle collisions elegantly and intelligently. Another way of thinking about hash tables and the size of a hash table in real-world contexts is with the example of a dictionary or a phone book. If we repicture what a dictionary looks like as a hash table, we can imagine that every single word in a dictionary has to map to one of the letters of the English alphabet. For example, since there are 26 letters in the English alphabet, every single word in the dictionary must fall into one of those 26 categories. So, in a hash table context, a dictionary or a phone book could be mapped into a hash table with 26 hash buckets. Here's an example of a phone book or a dictionary. Let's say that we wanted to find someone whose name started with the letter Z. Being able to locate the hash bucket for that specific person's name would be pretty easy. We would just need the key to find that person's name in the phone book. You can imagine that we might have a hash function that would pull the first letter from someone's name and determine the index that mapped to that letter. For example, if we wanted to find somebody whose name started with the letter Z, we could take that input data, pass it into our hash function, which would then tell us to go to the hash bucket with the index that mapped to Z. Finding a single element in a huge data set is much easier once you know the key for where it lives. The phone book example is a great way of understanding why a hash table will have far fewer buckets than the sheer amount of data that it actually holds. There are tons of names in the phone book, and yet all of the names that begin with the letter A will live at the same hash bucket. We know that not all names are evenly distributed amongst the 26 letters of the alphabet. There are going to probably be a lot more names that start with the letter A than those that start with the letter X. This is known as clustering. Clustering occurs when data in a hash table is not evenly distributed. Hash tables are only efficient if they can search through data quickly. For a clustered hash table, it becomes increasingly more difficult to do that. If all of your data lives at one or two buckets, then you're going to constantly find yourself having to search through the data in those two buckets again and again. If you want to learn more about how a hashing function should be structured, or how hashing functions deal with collisions, you should check out the article that accompanies this video. Without leveraging hash tables, we'd probably end up choosing a linked list or an array to solve the problem of finding a single item in a large data set. If we used an array or linked list implementation, we'd have to search through our data set until we found the title that we are looking for. If the title that we are looking for wasn't at the beginning of our linked list or array, and instead was at the end, well, we could be searching for a very long time. With the hash table, we can rely on a clever hash function to do this work for us. To find a single item in a large data set, all we have to do is pass our input data into our hash function. Our hash function will then tell us exactly where to go look. There's no need to go look through the entire data set. We can target our efforts and look exactly in the one place we know where our element will be. This is the difference between linear search or O of N time versus what a hash table's efficiency is. Because a hash table will always take the same amount of time to find an element, regardless of whether it's at the beginning of the list or the end, we can say that it takes a constant amount of time. Constant time is really awesome, and it's what we should strive to achieve. The great thing about constant time is that no matter how our data set grows, we don't have to worry about our algorithm to find a single item crashing on us. It's still going to be just as easy to find a single element in our hash table when there's 10 items in it versus if there are 10 million. How does this fit into libraries? Well, most library systems in the world today use something called the Dewey Decimal System. The Dewey Decimal System can really be restructured to be a hash table with 10 buckets. The Dewey Decimal System categorizes and groups books based on their category. For example, books in the category and genre of technology would be bucketed into the hash bucket 600. On the other hand, books that fall into the category of science would be bucketed into the hash bucket 500. You can imagine that the hashing function for the Dewey Decimal System's hash table is probably pretty complicated. But under the hood, that's all that's happening. I hope you understand and have a better appreciation for hash tables and their functions now. To check out the rest of my articles and videos, head over to dev2/Vaidehi Joshi. Thanks for watching.